Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. In this week's episode, I'll show you how I added the ability to craft basic shelters into my game. So last week, I made it possible to harvest resources from trees. This week, we'll make it so you can take those resources to your favourite spot and build your first structure. Just before I get into it, in place of comment of the week this week, I just wanted to thank everyone for the incredible words of encouragement you've all been sending my way. It really does help to keep me motivated. If you want to support the series, the best way is to share it with someone else you think might enjoy it. With that out of the way, it's time to get started. I imagine even a basic shelter would take quite a few materials to build, so I wanted to start by making items stackable. Next, I wanted the player to be able to claim a worksite where they can drop off materials they need for making their shelter. I'll do a bit of work on a custom shader to make the land claim border stand out. I'll then model the new shelter and add a way of constructing it. Last up will be demo time, where I'll show the result of this week's work and go over some improvements I'd like to try later. I always prefer my game mechanics to draw from the real world, so I came up with two different ways that items can stack. Items obviously have volume and take up space, which is important when working out how much of an item you can fit in a container. But sometimes, it's how unwieldy something is that matters. The volume of sticks and branches is not so important when you're carrying a bundle of them under your arm. I modified my item data scriptable object to let me configure how much of a character's grip should be used by an item and its volume. Some items, though, only make sense as a volume. Piles of leaves or needles and things like water behave as continuous fluids. It doesn't make much sense to say, I have three piles of spruce needles, so I added a flag to support continuous items such as these. I changed my inventory slot so that I can configure the capacity of each slot. I also added the concept of unlimited slots, which I'll take advantage of when I implement land claims today. I was getting tired of making a hand axe every time I wanted to test something, so I added a debug key that lets me quickly place an item into my primary hand. Trying out the harvesting system again, you can see that we can now pick up a few of each item. Branches stack 5 deep in each hand, sticks stack to 10, needles are difficult to move around once they've been separated from a branch, so they stack to 4 litres. About a gallon, basically a ball of 20 centimeters diameter. One concern I have is that there's a lot of clicking around to fully harvest a tree, and it's just not fun. I have a few ideas for addressing this. Maybe I can add a harvesting UI that shows what nearby things can be broken down, and lets you break them down from there. Harvesting should take time and effort by the player. I'm not much of a fan of the usual click fest that you get in most survival games, so perhaps it could be automated to some extent, but with an optional mini-game that allows you to speed up or otherwise improve the harvesting process. With item stacking out of the way, it's time to define a work area. I'm not sure how I want the player to request a land claim. In other games, a similar concept is often triggered by placing a particular item in the world. I may go down that path too, but for now, I'll just implement it as a command the player can choose, only once by targeting the ground. The land claim is represented by a sphere. It's not so useful rendered with a standard material, like dirt, so I made a custom shader to generate an effect that I think looks okay. It's based pretty heavily on Brecky's force field effect. My effect has two main sections to it. The bottom section draws a sphere in such a way that it is only visible near where it intersects the terrain. It does this by controlling the alpha output of the fragment shader. It takes the alpha channel of the screen position in raw mode, which gives a representation of the distance from the camera to the point on the sphere being rendered. It subtracts an offset that gives me more control over how much of the land claim sphere is visible above the terrain. It then gets multiplied by another parameter, allowing me to further control the appearance. This depth value then gets subtracted from the scene depth configured for eye sampling. This provides the distance from the camera to the terrain already drawn behind the land claim sphere. When we do this subtraction, we get a value proportional to the distance from the land claim sphere and the terrain behind it. This will come out to zero, or fully transparent, when they're right next to each other, and approach 1, or fully opaque, when they're far apart. We do a 1 minus to invert that, and apply a smooth step to ensure the value is clamped between 0 and 1. To demonstrate this bottom section, we can wire it directly to the alpha output and take a look. As you can see, it is bright close to the terrain, and gradually fades away as it gets further from the terrain. The top half of the shader is based around this Voronoi generator just here. It takes the current time and applies that as an offset to the generator's UV, causing it to animate. With a couple of other parameters providing further control over the appearance of the effect, it ultimately takes a Voronoi and cubes it to increase the contrast. We then clamp it between 0 and 1, then multiply the result by the edge feathering part of the effect. The end result is sort of a fiery look that I think looks pretty good for a virtual border. I wanted the items located within the land claim to be available to the player, so it made sense to add a little inventory UI that appears when the player is within their claim. I reused the inventory slot UI I already had, but the code is really hacky. It literally just scans all the objects in the game on every frame and displays anything within range at the center of the claim on the claim inventory UI. It did the job for now though. Again, there was a lot of clicking to get resources into the worksite, but I'm sure I can improve this later. Even just allowing items to be dragged between the various slots would improve things a lot here, in my opinion. So next, it was time to create the shelter itself. I went into Blender, took my spruce stick model, and built the frame for the shelter. By applying a series of loop cuts and offsetting the middle of the stick with proportional editing mode turned on, I was able to give the horizontal sticks a nice sort of bend. I added a couple of panels to represent the walls, and gave them a yellowish material as if they were made out of dried out needles. I added a construct command to the game, and hard-coded a new recipe within the construct code. The recipe is going to need 13 sticks and 20 liters of spruce needles. That's probably not very realistic, but lets me test out the idea. When the player asks to construct the shelter, it checks that the building materials are available, removes them, instantiates the new shelter, then increases the size of the land claim as a reward. So now it's demo time. Today I'll run through the demo from the start, since I plan on putting construction and crafting aside for the time being. We start by fetching the hammer stone and a flat stone, which we use to construct a hand axe. Next, we go find a tree and cut all the branches off it. To save carrying lots of resources around, we make a land claim at the base of the tree and break the branches down until we have at least 13 sticks and 20 liters of needles. And then lastly, we construct the shelter. Ultimately, I'd like the player to be able to construct more than just this one shelter. I'd like to play with the idea of blueprints, where the character can gain access to new designs and with the right skills, eventually even make their own designs to either construct or maybe even trade. Next week, I'll be making a start on multiplayer and may also start experimenting with changes to the game's controls so I can start looking at getting the game in other people's hands for playtesting. If you enjoyed this episode, don't forget to leave a like and share it with a friend. If you didn't enjoy it but watched to the end anyway, be sure to leave a mean comment down below. And until next time, happy game developing!